Dr. Arpita now.
Respected Chairperson Dr. Alexander Thomas, my co-panelists, my teacher, Professor Nandimat, and Dr. Kantikarji, and to all the delegates, a very good afternoon to all of you. The topic that I have been given by the organizer, Dr. Lalu, is recent verdicts and learnings from that. So I believe every judgment that comes from the Supreme Court of India is a learning for all of us, because that's the apex court. So you can't go beyond that. If it's a judgment of the Consumer Forum or if it is a judgment of the High Court, you can always, think of an appeal and, be a little relaxed until you have a judgment from the Supreme Court of India. So, but, for the easier point of discussion, I have just taken three cases, which have recently come up. Just trying to, understand, I'm not going to talk much of law because, I believe it is important for us to understand how simple things can be corrected first before we get into complicated aspects of law. So recently there was a judgment by the Supreme Court of India. The facts go very simple that, the patient gives an informed, informed consent for undergoing laparoscopic surgery. And then the doctor realizes that, she will have to undergo a conventional surgery because there's some swelling or so in her gallbladder, right? So the informed consent is now for the laparoscopic surgery, and the patient is now, undergone a conventional surgery. The case is before the court, and interesting, the court, of course, the court, decides in favor of the doctor. But then what is very important is, when you talk about informed consent, we see that doctors get very, very reactive. And then they come and say, my informed consent is just so much in place, why still am I held responsible? And then you try to make that consent form so complex, looking at so many judgments that have been coming from the courts, that of course it becomes very complex for the court also to then decide, and then they'll say, okay, fine, let me hold this doctor responsible, right? But what is important is you owe a duty to the patient. That is very important, and the standard of care that you owe is very important. What you have to realize is, you do your duty as a doctor. Informed consent is a necessity. You have to do it, and do it to the best possible extent. If you have a patient's proxy who's sitting outside, and if you have to go, you can't take the simple defense saying that I've already taken an informed consent. Do I really need to inform the patient's attendant? Do that as well. I'm sure all of you are already doing that. But the only problem that comes is, we start making these legal documents very, very, very complex, giving witnesses, having more of witnesses and thinking our document probably will have a much better legal standing. That's not the case in a lot of cases at all. So I would normally, suggest, we've been doing a lot of, consultations for drafting informed consents and, template model consents. So when we tell doctors, you just write the doctor's name. If in case a patient wants to have more of, detailing with you, it's always important that you write. I'm sure most of you are doing it. But then the doctors again come back and say, madam, on the letterhead I've already written. Why should I again mention my, phone number? So there's a scare every time that, if my name is mentioned, will I only be held responsible? If my phone number is, mentioned and I answer the patient, would that be a, difficult problem? But that's not the case. So I think, don't get into too much of legal documentation. But at the same time, be a little bit reasonable with the law side of it also. The other point is, a lot of judgments, I happened to see Dr. Kantikar's judgment itself. It was on some IVF, procedure that the patient had to undergo, and it wasn't successful, right? So a lot of treatments and all of that, and then they come before the court saying that, and it's his own judgment. But what is interesting is, you will see that judges are also looking into a lot of medical literature, right? They are looking into medical literature, which is being written from you doctors. It's not law at that point of time at all. It's more to do with World Health Organization's documentations, and how many of us have so much of time to read it. But it is very apt that almost all cases that these days are coming before the court of laws are being looked into by a doctor, he himself a doctor, so probably he was on the most rational part of it. But as a judge of the Supreme Court, I'm sure they are going to look into more of medical literature. But we don't see more of literature coming from the medical professionals at all. I mean, that could be a defense saying that, we're so busy with patients that, we don't have much time to write. And now you know how our handwriting is. But you will still see State Consumer Forum has now fined 5,000 rupees for, eligible handwriting by doctors also. do we really want to get into that phase? I mean, these little things like handwriting and all of that, I think can be a better improvement, you know, both for the patient and for the doctor also. One of my last case discussions would be, I'm sure all of us have heard about this Aruna Shanbhog's judgment, which came back in, which was in the year 2011. The discussion there was simple. It was on, you know, passive euthanasia, right? And the judge goes on to define what is passive euthanasia. And everything was simple. Nobody questioned you. Doctors also did not question that. But when we happened to do a little bit of research on that, we started getting a lot of doubts on, you know, what is passive euthanasia? Is it withholding of treatment, withdrawing of treatment, all the medical terminologies? After about 7 years, I'm sure all of you have heard about the recent case that came up on whether right to die with dignity is a fundamental right under our constitution, right? So what happened there is, because nobody spoke in the Aruna Shanbhog's case, the Supreme Court, interestingly, you know, with a bench of 5-judge bench, goes on to define what is withholding of treatment and what is withdrawing of treatment. Interestingly, all the 4 judges in that judgment consider withholding and withdrawing the same. And there's one judge who begs to differ from that. Now, I don't know how many of you are understanding the criticality of this simple definition of withholding and withdrawing. You know, that can put you behind bars a lot of cases because, you know, you don't know if you are going to, be held responsible under Section 304A of the, Criminal Procedure Code, right? But then nobody has come up again defending, nobody has come up with a position paper on that. That gives us a little bit of concern for, you know, medical professionals, because if you leave judges to decide for you, then what are you going to decide, right? It is also on the aspect of legal validity of advanced directives that they've also spoken about. That goes on the same. What about your autonomy? If I, as a patient, have to decide when I will die, even if I'm fine, if I take that liberty, what would you do in the best interest of a patient? Right? These are all critical aspects which I see in a lot of judgments that, you know, we happen to come across. And with the interactions that we've been doing with a lot of our scholars in CMC and Madurai with the postgraduate diploma in medical law and ethics, now we've taken a little bit of, you know, stern decision that, you know, we have to work on working papers so that, you know, your position papers or your writings would be a lot more helpful for the judiciary and, you know, to decide and discuss upon cases. So, you know, the best learning is, in spite of you being the best doctor, in spite of you having the best documentation, there could be, you know, fate deciding against you also. So the last, point that I would want to make is, you know, please believe in divinity. That is all that I would have to say. So thank you once again to all of you.